I get many questions, and although I try to answer as many as possible, there are questions that deserve more attention or longer answer than I can usually give at the community page. So I give them in this video. Your positive comments are very much appreciated. It's great to hear that my videos are helpful and informative to many. And your continuing monetary support is really heartwarming. Perhaps the QR donation code did help a bit, but I certainly experience it as a clear sign of your appreciation for my work, even though absorbing the info is hard work to many. Outstanding video, Hans, although I will need to watch it at least one more time to fully absorb the substantial information contained in this video. I already understand several concepts better, thank you. Believe it or not, I have the same. I might be just a few miles ahead of you, but I have to read or view information that's completely new to me 3 to 5 times. But I would rather have that than broad shallow information. I gather you feel the same. Is product A better than product B? Or does product A sound better than product B? I get loads of questions like these. I review only equipment that might be interesting to you, mostly because it's equipment that offers good sound quality and features for the money. Very rarely I will publish a review because I think the internet hypes it too much and that needs to be put in place. Between two products I review in the same price category, there won't be a great performance difference. That doesn't mean that they can't sound different, but that is personal. Where one will prefer an R2R ladder converter DAC, another might prefer an oversampling DAC. I try to describe the sound character and the features in my review so you can decide for yourself what's the best choice for you. Therefore, I almost never answer questions like this. View my reviews, think them over and decide what might be the best choice for you. Almost always, you already pick the product you can't go wrong with. Does it pay to replace the power supply of my streamer? Do you think it's worth having a linear power supply for an AVR? Upgrading a power supply for the streamers, DACs and switches is easily done when it's a power brick or wall wart type. And it can improve the sound quality drastically, depending on the quality of the new chosen one and the original power supply. Often these are cheap switch mode power supplies that produce a lot of high frequency noise in the DC power. That will distort the sound in the unit it powers. Often it is replaced by a so-called linear power supply that doesn't produce HF noise. But a better switch mode power supply can be a better solution too. For instance, the iFi silent power products are affordable and a lot better than the cheap power supplies that come with affordable streamers. A good linear power supply, like the popular S-Booster models, will give a further sound improvement. However, linear power supplies often are less capable of delivering high currents instantly, something digital audio equipment needs to sound good. So often switch mode power supplies sound better on fully digital equipment like digital transports, streamers without integrated DACs and switches. In equipment that has both digital and analog circuits, often, but not always, a quality linear power supply sounds better. For amplifiers and AV receivers, things are different. Many already have linear power supplies, but if they don't, it might already be a very good switch mode power supply. If that's not the case, you need a custom-built linear power supply, since these devices use several voltages on several power lines. 5 volts for the digital circuits, often around 20 volts for the low power analog electronics, and an even higher voltage plus high amperage for the power amps. In practice, it's undoable. Which line input should I connect the subwoofer to on my amp? I don't see a separate sub input. There are three ways to connect a subwoofer. Some amplifiers have a separate subwoofer output. It's an output, not an input. Just connect a single RCA cable between that output and the low-level input on the subwoofer. You then have to make sure that the sub only plays really low sounds. Check if the amp has built-in filters. If so, switch those on and disable the filter on the sub. If not, use the filters on the sub. The second way is to use a preamplifier output, often called pre-out, and connect that to the low-level input on the sub. Since the preamp output has no filtering applied, set the filtering on the subwoofer. The third way, my favorite, is to use the high-level input, provided your sub has this input. You connect that input with the loudspeaker terminals of your amp. Before you do that, check if your amp allows for negative speaker terminals to be grounded. Some amplifiers, like my Air Acoustics amp and amplifiers in bridge mode, will get defective if you do that. In that case, you connect the minus wire coming from the subwoofer to the chassis of the amp and the left and right positive wires of the sub to the left and right positive speaker terminals on your amp. Since the amp doesn't have a filter, you use the filters on the subwoofer. For more on setting up your sub, see my video Subwoofer Placement and Settings. Links in the top right corner at the end of this video and in the description. I'm surprised by your recommendation to use Wi-Fi. I would have thought that Ethernet would always be better. Again, there's no absolute truth. Not every Wi-Fi access point performs equally, and the same goes for the Wi-Fi receiver in your stereo. But a good Wi-Fi access point combined with audio equipment that handles Wi-Fi well can give a very good result if, at your location, the Wi-Fi band is not too busy. The main advantage of Wi-Fi is that, in contrast to Ethernet, a number of disturbances, like some forms of noise, won't be transferred. But the signal can be less stable. Especially the 2.4 GHz band can give problems since it travels through the walls relatively easy and can suffer from your microwave, baby phone, etc. The advantage of 2.4 GHz is a wider range. The higher bands, like 5 and 6 GHz, offer a shorter range, meaning you often need to have an access point in your listening room. But it also means that Wi-Fi of your neighbor might not reach your room. And these bands don't suffer from microwaves and baby phones and the like. In my situation, nothing beats Ethernet with expensive Ethernet filtering. If you can, try both out. If you don't hear a difference, there is no difference. If I'm going to use a WiiM Ultra with external DAC, is a new power supply even needed? I'm thinking of using an upgraded power supply on the DAC. In general, I think it's wiser to use a streamer with integrated DAC, since the sound quality of the streamer and the DAC will normally be equal. If you add up the price of a streamer, a separate DAC, a good power supply and a proper digital cable, you might end up higher than the price of, for instance, a Bluesound Node 130, an Arcam Radia SD5 or a Volumio Primo. But if you already own a WiiM, that might not be an option. Then a quality switch mode power supply like the iFi silent power models can improve the audio quality, depending on how good the rest of your stereo is. When I was investigating moving from CD to streaming from NAS, I was surprised at what huge difference digital cables made, and that decided me to make the transition, as I then enjoyed streaming sound better than that of the CD player I had. Plus it was more convenient. Yes, digital cables can make a big difference. In general, having a cable with the correct impedance over a wideband is mandatory. For SPDIF, that's 75 ohms. For AES/EBU, 110 ohms. And for USB, 120 ohms. Even then, there can be a difference in, for instance, the quality of shielding, and the construction might influence microphony. that can cause the cable to produce a small signal due to vibrations. And then there is the crystal structure of the metal used. It is generally said that if oxygen creeps in between the crystals in a cable, it forms a semiconductor, and that influences the sound signal to a certain degree. You might hear improvements on a 1500 euro stereo, but on a 50,000 euro one, you will for sure. By the way, you might get the same quality from a CD player, but indeed, not the convenience. I would like to know if using a Roon ROG server with two network ports, one connected to the switch and one connected directly to the network streamer, would not be the best sounding solution. Connecting an audio server directly to your streamer will need some awareness of network technology. Since the connection is made directly, there is no DHCP, the dynamic host configuration protocol, that hands out IP addresses to both the music server and the streamer, so you need to set an IP address by hand on the streamer and the port of the server you will use. Do it wrong and it will not work. It is questionable if, under normal domestic conditions, there will be an improvement in sound quality. Do you recommend room correction? I'm guessing no, in general, as it is DSP at work. My listening room is quite good dimensionally and acoustically. The question is, in essence, what gives the best sound quality? Any digital signal processing causes loss, like any analog tone control. The advantage of digital is that it can be more clever compared to analog. Some digital room correction systems are just multi-band parametric equalizers that don't correct the resulting time behavior. Systems like Direct Live do the compensation for time behavior, and that's already a better way. By the way, it is called room correction, but it corrects the entire chain between the room corrector and your ears, so including the DAC, the amp and the loudspeakers. But if your acoustics have no great flaws and your player, amp and speakers are of very good quality, you might be better off without room correction. I hope you have enjoyed these answers. Probably they will generate new questions, and that's fine. I will try to answer them again. For now, we come to the end of this video. Next week, there is a part 2, so don't forget to subscribe or follow me on Patreon, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram or TikTok. Patreon and YouTube premium members get early access and no ads. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and share it. It really helps. A huge thanks to everyone who supports this channel financially. You keep me independent and that means a lot. Even 1 euro, pound or dollar makes a difference. You can use the QR code on screen or the links in the description to contribute. I'm Hans Beekhuizen. Thank you for watching. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.